into God's word. So pray with me. Father God, slow us down, God. Like we hear songs and we maybe joke, this is a hustle and bustle in this season, and there truly is. And so slow us down. When we come into this room, would you slow us down long enough to capture our hearts? That's truly what we desire. We seek you to capture our hearts. All our senses, our eyes, our ears, just show us yourself today as we read your word. And in this Advent season, would we be all the more intentional to gather and to celebrate what it is that you have done and are doing in each and every one of our lives, even when it doesn't make sense. And so be with us today, Emmanuel, God with us. In your name we pray, amen. Let me just set the stage a little bit because some of us may be familiar with Advent, some of us may not be familiar with Advent. The word Advent is not as scary as maybe what we've made it out to be. The word Advent simply just means to anticipate, to wait, to have this urgency of posture. And all of this urgency of posture, all of this waiting, all of this anticipating is for Jesus. It's for the birth of Jesus. Now we have our Bibles in front of us, or we maybe have read Luke chapter 2, where we know the birth of Jesus has already taken place. Why are we waiting for the birth of Jesus? Well, right, that makes total sense, and that's a great question. But still, even thousands and thousands of years removed from the event of God sending his son Jesus in the form of a baby, we still wait for him to work in our lives. And as Leighton said, we wait for the second coming because Jesus promised he would come back. Amen? Anybody? Like that should be reassuring for us because we live in a time where we have aches and pains of the things that we face. We have aches and pains of the world that we live in because of the jobs that we have or because of the relationships we have, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Because of the context that we live in or the political environment or the socioeconomic environment. Like we live in a world that has aches and pains, and so we anticipate Jesus. We need you with us. And so this season of Advent gives you and me an opportunity to simply do one thing, to lean toward Jesus. Like, I don't know about you, but for me, this is my favorite season. And I'm not just saying that because I'm a pastor and I'm supposed to say that. No. Like, I feel it inside of me, and it's not just the two or three cups of coffee I had today. Like there is something inside of me, like, drawing all the more into to wanting Jesus personally to be near me, to guide me, to lead me. Like, I want to lean in all the more for the sake of my marriage to Hannah, that Jesus, you be there for us. I want to lean in all the more as father to Ella and Olive. Like, I want, just desire so much. And there's something about this Christmas season that draws us together. Whether we like it or not, you were already in those homes of those people you were forced to be with this last week, right? Some of you are like, amen. There's something about this season. And friend, like, just hear me. We can be honest in this room. There's something about this season that we yearn for more of him, right? We yearn for Jesus to make sense of who we are and where we're at. And so, would you take full advantage with me? Would we not take this season for granted? But would we lean in all the more? And so we do it as a church. This is my sixth year as pastor, and so we've done it this way, where we have these Advent candles, and we have a reading and a lighting. And I'm super excited because these candles were actually made by some friends of mine and Hannah's. We got to spend some time with them during the Thanksgiving break. They have a little plug, selfish plug, the beeswax department out of Seguin. It's owned and run by some close friends, and they provided our candles this year, and they handmade them for us last Monday. And so selfishly, I'm super pumped for that, but also every time we get together and light one of these candles, it's, again, just all the more the anticipation as we want to draw near the closeness and warmthness of our Savior Jesus. And so we'll do that. And this is the hope candle, and we're going to talk about and read about hope in God's Word today. And then next week will be the peace candle, and a sermon about peace. And then the next week will be joy. Like, how many of you would say, I need some joy this season? Okay, good. Two people. The rest of us are full of it, right? Full of joy, that is. Full of joy. And then the last week, the fourth Sunday of Advent, is love. L-O-V-E, love. I say it all the time. Gets a bad rap in the world that we live in today. And so we will look in God's Word to experience and encounter God's love. And so that's where this Advent season, that's, you know already, you have all the answers, that's where we're going this Advent season. Now, let me give you, this is kind of a weird Sunday because I have two intros and then one sermon. So that was the first intro. So you ready for the second intro? Okay, good. Rick, go to the next slide. I just want to kind of tell you where my mind works differently than most people, and it kind of like, have those squirrel moments where you kind of go off into just a random place. And so as I'm kind of reading the last couple of months, and I found myself in Proverbs again, Proverbs chapter 20, verse 12, and it says this. It says, ears that hear and eyes that see, the Lord has made them both. Ears that hear, eyes that see, the Lord has made them both. Again, let's just be honest. I've told this story before. I went to Hannah, my wife's optometrist, because Hannah's had glasses like her whole life. And so I noticed just a little blurriness as I'm reading. And so I went to the optometrist, and the optometrist said these words to me that I'm still offended, and it's been over a year. I was just turned 40, and she said, I was just about to turn 40 a year ago, and she said, well, really offensive. And now that I'm 41, I think my eyes are 42 already, because I have to get plus ones when I read now. And like when I read from my iPad, they're really big words, so I can see them. Maybe some of you have the same issue as it pertains to your hearing, because it seems like our eyes and ears fail us, right? Anybody else feeling that? No? It's humbling, isn't it? Spiritually, I feel spiritually the same is true. Spiritually, our eyes and ears, the older we get, the more comfortable we get in our faith, the more comfortable we get in our churches, our eyes and our ears seem to fail us. Where we feel like we've got it all figured out already. And so this Advent season, for me, after I read Proverbs 20, verse 12, the theme for me is see and hear. I want, personally, and I want us corporately, as a group of people, I want us to see and hear Jesus in a whole new way. Young and old, from the kids that are downstairs right now to us that are adults or senior adults. Like, I want us to experience in seeing and hearing Jesus in a whole new way, in a way that changes us like never before. I've been in church since I was in the fourth grade, and I think sometimes I take that for granted. Maybe you have felt that or are feeling that too. Maybe you're new to the faith or new to joining and participating in church. Eyes and ears don't fail us. But would we all the more see our eyes and ears physically and spiritually as a gift because God made them? But would we also, with our eyes and our ears, experience Jesus in a whole different way? Second intro. Now, It's interesting that we bring up eyes and ears, because look at this next passage. Luke chapter 24. If you have your Bibles, if you've got it on a mobile device or you have a physical Bible, Luke chapter 24 is one place where we're going to be today. And then if you want to get ready already, and both of these will be up on the screen, but the second place that I want us to be in Scripture is Isaiah 40. So Luke chapter 24, and then Isaiah. Isaiah's in the Old Testament. Luke is in the New Testament. Now, new Bibles and a couple devotional books, and they're up on the bookshelves in the front room. And I always say this, if you don't have a Bible, if you don't have a Bible you like, or a Bible that you don't use, or you don't want to use because it's maybe a family heirloom or something, there are brand new Bibles. Two of them are still in plastic. That's how new they are. I wanted you to know, like, no one else has touched this before. There are new Bibles up in the front room. If you need one or you want one, just take it. No one's going to judge you. No one's going to chase you out of here. But I just want you to know that it's important. We value here the importance of reading God's Word, being in God's Word all throughout the week, especially new ones in there if you want to take one. I'm giving you permission. But in the meantime, Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 27 says this. Now, that same day, now hold on. In fact, this is the last chapter of Luke's gospel. And Jesus, at this point, has lived, he died, he was buried, and he has now risen back to life. And this same day is the Sunday where the women go to the tomb and the stone is rolled away and he's not in the tomb. And everyone's freaking out. You guys remember that story? Now, we'll get to this as the new year's about to get here, and then we get closer to the Lent season or the Easter season. We're going to get there, but we might be familiar with this. That's the day that this is taking place. Now, that same day, two of them were going to the village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. Verse 14, they were talking with each other about everything that had happened. Everything that had happened was what? Jesus' ministry, living, Jesus' arrest, crucifixion, death, and burial. And his body's not there. That's what they're talking about. They were talking about it with each other, about everything that had happened. Verse 15 and 16. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but what? Was kept from recognizing him. Eyes are failing them. They don't see that it's Jesus. Verse 17, Jesus asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? They stood still, their faces what? Okay, if you've got a Bible or you can take a screenshot, that should be highlighted, circled, squared, underlined, that word downcast. Now we're going to get back to that word, but let me say this before we go further. If you want to raise your hand, you can. If not, how many of us, more often than hope, peace, joy, and love in the Christmas season, feel and experience downcast? It's kind of where we find ourselves more often than not, isn't it? Whether it's because fearing something, weathering. Now, let me say this before we go any further. It is okay, anyone here, but I want to give you permission. I want to give us permission to feel down, to acknowledge the brokenness inside, the hurt, the fear, the anxiety, the worry. Like, this is a safe place. Like, if we can't express and feel and sit in that in here together, then where else are you going to feel it and sit in it? So let's feel it together. Like, there are things that we're facing. There are things that we have faced. There are things that we don't even know, and sometimes that brings us, because it's in that together, and we're going to see here in a little downcast that we find hope. And so if you got to feel it today. If we need to that happened these days. In verse 19, Jesus is just playing with them now, What things, he asks. Verse 20, about Jesus of Nazareth, they replied. He was a prophet. Pilate handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped, key word, hoped, Israel. They're amazing women, but they didn't find Jesus' body. They came and they told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Verse 24, then some of our companions see Jesus. Eyes are failing him. He, Jesus, said to them, verse 25, man, and how slow to, that's supposed to say to believe all the called a fool, right? How foolish we are. How foolish they were. How slow to believe all the prophets had spoken. Look at verse 26. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and enter his glory? Jesus is saying, I told you this was going to happen. Jesus is saying, didn't the prophets in the Old Testament, which they didn't call it the Old Testament at the time, didn't your readings say this was about to happen? This was going to take place. Look at verse 27. And this is where we're going this Advent season. Verse 27. And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. This is why Leighton and I do our best to over and over and over and over and over again say we must have the Bible in front of us at all times. Jesus, in this moment, with these two downcast men, said, you know what? I'm going to take the time from Moses and all the prophets, explain to all the scriptures, point using scriptures to point everything back to me. You and I have the opportunity to have scripture in our hands and on our projectors and on our mobile devices so that we can read it and experience it with our eyes and with our ears and everything that is about us, because it all points to him. I dare you, not right now, because I want you to listen. I dare you to read the rest of the story from Luke 24. Because they still don't know it's Jesus. I'm just going to tell you, spoiler alert, if you haven't read it. They go into their home, and Jesus is pretending he's going to walk away, and they're like, no, stay here with us. They eat some food together. They break bread together. And then amazingly, Jesus reveals himself. Their eyes work again. They see that it is Jesus. And then, do you know what happens? Jesus disappears in that moment. Ah. But the best part is this, not the disappearing act by Jesus. The best part is they look at each other. This is in Luke 24. You could read it yourself. They say, weren't our hearts burning when he was telling us these things? When we turn to Isaiah 40 right now, we're not doing it because I've got about 10 minutes left. We're doing it so that our hearts burn inside of us, because the scripture is pointing to Jesus. They were moved. It wasn't heartburn. It was Jesus using scripture to move and stir something inside of them that they couldn't explain in that moment. But the moment their eyes were focused and enlightened to Jesus, and their ears and all of them, something was happening. I desire that something to happen inside of us today. I desire in this season, again, I will make this petition. My prayer has been that this is what moves us this season. That would move us in such a way that changes. Now this is it right here, before we get to Isaiah 40. I have an agenda. I'm going to give you my agenda. That this would move us in such a way that we would leave here today and operate in a different way, in a life-giving way, for the sake of the families that we belong to, the workplaces you got to go to tomorrow, the school campuses that we got to be attending to, the community that God has put you in is the community not by accident, but He wants to use you there in such a way that points others to Him. And so this is extremely important, that we would be moved and our senses would be enlightened in such a way that empowers us to act, that brings glory to Him for the sake of others seeing Him. And so with that in mind, let's go to Isaiah 40. Now, Lane and I were sitting in this room yesterday, and we just kind of sat back there where Frank is for about 45 minutes. This Frank, not that Frank. We were sitting over here, Lane and I, yesterday for about 45 minutes just talking about you. All good. Talking about us as we gather in this season. And we talked about he was going to read from Isaiah 40. And then I went home and I started reading Isaiah 40 for myself. And I should have given him one more verse, because Leighton read Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. But I think we need verse 27. So I added verse 27 for us to see. So look at verse 27. Now, before I read this, we probably should know this. Isaiah, the book of Isaiah in the Old Testament is a pretty large book. It's a great one. Isaiah chapter 1 to Isaiah chapter 39 paints a story of God's people in the wrong and God punishing them. It's not a good story. I mean, it's a good story, but it's not a good story. Like, we don't put ourselves in that part of the story, right? We should, but we don't. Chapter 40 is where the script flips. Better said, it's a springboard. Chapter 40 is the springboard where God says, yet this is what I'm going to do with you people who are running away from me. And so Isaiah chapter 40, verse 27 says this, why do you complain, Jacob? Why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? This tells our story, doesn't it? This is like saying that maybe you and I often say, where are you, God? Have you ever said that before? Where are you? Like, you said you would be there. It doesn't feel like it. Or maybe we begin to bargain. If you do this, then I will. And he doesn't ever seem to. So I'm not going to then. Have you ever said that? How many of you are really good at complaining? Nobody wants to raise their hand. 27 of Isaiah 40 paints a downcast picture of God's people then in the Old Testament, and it paints a pretty good picture of us today, doesn't it? Earlier, I got to teach one of the adult Sunday school classes, and I said this, and this is, I love, again, this is another little insight for the season that we are in today, starting today. So if you have your Bibles, the last book of the Old Testament is Malachi, and the first book of the New Testament is what? Matthew. There is a thin page in between Malachi and Matthew. That thin page, I wrote this on all my Bibles. You can do this on yours unless you're not into writing on books or Bibles. It represents about 600, that thin page, 600 to 700 years is what that page means. But 600 to 700 years where God doesn't say or do anything. Imagine, we can't go 30 minutes without our DoorDash. How are we going to do with 600 years of God not showing up, right? That's what makes Advent all the more special. Because right now, it's a 25, and we know to, you know, I got to watch, you know what team I'm watching, right? Good luck. How's that working out? Imagine what it would be like if we anticipate God working for us with the same energy and boldness and confidence that he's going to show up and that he's going to work. Look at verse 28. Isaiah 40, verse 28. Do you not know, have you not heard, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of. This is Isaiah writing. This is us reading and seeing and hearing and experiencing like a shaking. Do you not know? Have you not heard? Like if there's, okay, this is like a first point of everything we're looking at today. See and hear God in all his greatness. See and hear God in all his greatness. Like we open up God's word. We open up these doors and look outside to see and hear and experience God, which means he's from the beginning and he's to the end forever. He is the creator. Like, think about Genesis chapter 1, which at times it's so hard to wrap our minds around, right? By his words, God spoke into being ends. In the dirt of the ground, he formed and fashioned man, woman, and then breathed life into them. And look at us now. God did that. See him and hear him and know him in all of his greatness. There's no accident by his hand. And here we are. Like we could look across this room and I stood right there and I could hear you singing. Like how marvelous, how wonderful. That is us declaring that we see and we hear God in all his greatness. Would that not stop when we leave here? But would that be the anthem that carries us out of here? How wonderful, how marvelous. See and hear God in all his greatness. Look at verse 28 as it continues. God will not grow tired and weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. Reminds me of Proverbs 3. It may be a familiar passage for you. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make your path straight. There is so far that our understanding, our creativity, our education, our strength can take us. But he takes us well beyond that. And I don't understand how he does it, but I want more of it. He won't grow tired or weary in his understanding no one can fathom. Look at this, as it downshifts here all the more. Verse 29 and 30. God, he gives strength to the weary. Another word for downcast is weary. So if you're sitting in here downcast, broken, anxious, full of worry, doubt, fear, hear these words. God gives strength to you. God increases the power of the weak. Even youth grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. I feel like the world today is selling youth. Do this, eat this, take this, apply this regimen, you'll live forever. Right? Anybody else been seeing that or feeling that? Trying it? No. Even youth grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. Look at verse 31. And if this isn't highlighted, circled, squared, or underlined in your Bible, it better be today. Like, it should be screenshotted and put on your phone lock screen. Verse 31. But those who what? You said it, I didn't. Those who hope in the Lord. Some Bible translations say wait. Same word. Hope and wait. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. If number one is see and hear the greatness of God and how it is everlasting to everlasting and how it's awesome and wonderful and we can't even fathom how great He is. Number two is this. Wait. Hope. How many of you are good at waiting and hoping? Thank you for being honest and not raising your hand. But those who hope, those who wait in the Lord will renew their strength. My favorite psalm, Psalm 5:3, it says this, "In the morning, Lord, I cry out to you. And in the morning, Lord, I wait in expectation." I recite that every single morning that I wake up. In the morning, Lord, some translation says, "Hear my voice." In the morning, Lord, hear my voice. And in the morning, Lord, I wait in expectation for you to do something today. That's what hoping in the Lord means. That's what waiting in the Lord means. What does this look like? In closing, verse 31 tells us what hoping, waiting looks like. Those who hope in the Lord, verse 31 says this, they will soar on wings like eagles. Those who hope in the Lord, they will run and not grow weary. Those who hope in the Lord, they will walk and not be faint. There is nothing you and I can conjure up to increase our energy, input and output. But hoping, waiting in God. And all the more this season, hoping and waiting. We will soar on wings like eagles, which is just an awesome picture, right? We will run and not grow weary. I'd love to run and not ever get tired of it. I'd love to be able to walk and to not be faint at the end of the day thinking, what did I do with my life today? And so two things before I pray and before we get out of here. See and hear how awesome, great, wonderful, and massive God is. Would the prayer be, God, open our eyes and our ears to see and hear you this season. And two, it's time to wait. It's time to hope. It's time to, as a church family, and as the families we represent, it's time to pause long enough to wait and hope for Him and expect Him to do something. So would you pray with me? Father God, here we are on this first Sunday of December, this first Sunday of the Advent season. All of us want to just wait. and hope. We seek to place our hope in no one or nowhere else but you. And so open up our eyes that we see. Open up our ears that we might hear. And shape and mold us, stretch us, mend our brokenness, and use us that we might tell others about you. God, we so need you, and we seek you, and we seek you together during this season, and we thank you for the opportunity of it. And it's in your name, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. Friends, have a great week. Hopefully we see you Wednesday. If not, we'll see you soon. Goodbye.